president of Maharishi University of Management, a member of the board of directors, and also dean of the Maharishi College of Perfect Health, our own R. Keith Wallace. What a joy to see you all. So fun to see Maharishi on that tape too. 1973, what a joy. This is a little extension of what Robert's talk, where he mentioned epigenetics. Epigenetics refers to one gene, working on one gene. Epigenomics refers to working on all the genes. And this whole area is called personalized medicine, and we're going to look at how epigenomics and Ayurveda, it's an area which I'm very interested in right now. So next slide. This is a quote by Maharishi. Maharishi, of course, loved DNA. DNA, in its innocence, sits there awake to its holistic nature. Then whatever is required, the environment draws from it. Whatever is necessary, the environment draws from it. The whole environment is the creation of DNA. And Maharishi loved DNA. That was like the unified field for Maharishi. This was really talking about Veda. He said one time that Veda rides on the backbone of DNA. Somehow this amazing structure of DNA is so critical to our evolution and to our lives. And Maharishi really wanted deeper and deeper exploration in this area. And so I'm really happy today that this research is coming out, because suddenly it takes us to a new level. And I think particularly in the area of Ayurveda, where nobody knows what vata, pitta, and kapha and all these terms mean, if you can translate it in terms of DNA, in terms of the expression of genes, suddenly the whole thing becomes more meaningful. Next slide. So epigenomics, the genome is the totality of our DNA, which is present in virtually all of our cells. During the process of development, the knowledge in DNA is sequentially unfolded. So this is an epigenomic process, development, as we go from fertilized egg and we develop. This is all turning on genes, turning off genes in different cells. The liver cell does something totally different than a heart cell. Some genes are being turned on, some are being turned off. But this process of turning on and off specific genes as a result of the interactions with the inner and outer environment is the process of epigenomics, which continues throughout our lifetime. And that's what Robert was mentioning, how important this is, how we realize now that everything we eat, everything we do, everything that we experience, Maharishi used to say that, you know, experience itself, whatever it was, sensory experience itself, had this influence on us. So any experience we have changes our genes. Obviously, meditation is shown to do that. Next slide. So let's look at what's happening in modern medicine first, and then we'll look at Ayurveda. So this is a whole new direction. The world is going toward personalized medicine. When you go and get drugs, especially if they're very powerful drugs, you'll have your DNA tested, your epigenomic status. You'll know which genes are turned on, which are turned off. And it turns out that this will help, because some people metabolize drugs very differently. Diet, exercise, nutritional supplements, all these things are affected by which genes are turned on and off. So next slide, we'll go through a few of these. So this is just kind of a preview. I thought this is one of the most interesting studies. It came out about 6 months ago. And what it showed was that our immune response, you know, it's kind of something we've always known. One kid in school gets sick, the other kid never gets sick. Somebody that's super pitta, go to India, drink the water. I remember Steven Benson in the early days going there. He could do anything. We were all just, you know, suffering immensely. He just could do anything. So it just depends upon your immune system. And this study looked at how people responded to infections in different ways and how this can be linked to gene expression. So it's just kind of a way of understanding how this works. Next slide. So they, as they do in science, they inoculated 17 healthy adults with influenza A, and then looked at changes in their peripheral blood gene expression, measured it 16 times over 132 hours. So they got a whole look at how the genes responded to this injection of influenza A. Next slide. And what they found was there, you know, you can measure 3,000-4,000 different genes all in a little chip. You get this incredible, neat little microchip, and it's just a piece of glass where all this chemicals are sketched on it, and it fluoresces, and you can determine, you know, 3,000-4,000 genes. I mean, you've got about 30,000 genes, but you start to isolate groups of them, and you can, and different cells, of course, they're not expressing all the genes, they're only expressing certain genes. So you can create these little microchips and figure out what's going on. And they found that there were 42 factors that were most important in distinguishing why somebody got a viral infection or not. Next slide. So this is a nice pretty chart. These are the asymptomatic people here. And this is time going this direction. And here we see before, this one is before. So the asymptomatic group, they got some, these are symptoms here, different kinds of symptoms, tiredness, so forth. These red marks here are the usual symptoms, like sneezing, all the kinds of swelling up, all the kinds of things, temperature and so forth. So this is the symptomatic group going across here, asymptomatic. So these guys, they'd get infected, but then nothing would happen. They'd get a little tired, and then they wouldn't get sick at all. These guys would get infected, and suddenly all these genes would be turned on, and they'd go through the normal inflammatory response, and you'd get all these symptoms here. Next slide. And what you see then is that there's unique gene expression pattern. And this is kind of a temporal pattern over time of gene expression, which differentiates the symptomatic from asymptomatic. So the guy that gets the cold and the guy that doesn't. Next slide. And this is very detailed. So you can look at any specific gene here. You look at, this is the asymptomatic group. This is the symptomatic group. So maybe it's a particular gene here that's in this asymptomatic group, it's blue. It's not turned on at all, completely off. Here in the symptomatic group, massively on. Another gene here over time, it starts to get turned on and on and on. The symptomatic group, these guys, that gene isn't even working. It's just completely not working at all. So it's off. So obviously, we're all doing different things. We're treating the environment differently. That virus comes up. Some of us are totally pitta, who knows what, and boom. They're getting rid of this virus before there's even a chance for it to even come into the body. Others are going through a whole process of getting a cold, inflammation, having the immune system attack it and destroy it. So we're all very, very different, just like Ayurveda has been telling us for many years. Next slide. Now, in drugs, this is important, because this whole area of pharmacogenomics is the study of how different individuals respond differently to drugs. The same dose of a drug will result in an elevated plasma concentration for some patients and low concentration for others. Some patients will respond well to drugs while others will not. A drug may show adverse effects in some patients but not others. So again, doctors have known this forever. And now we're realizing you could tailor drugs. I mean, not that we want to take pharmaceutical drugs anyway, but if you have to take them, it's nice that somehow they're finding out how you're metabolizing those drugs, and they're then adjusting the dose. So maybe you don't have to take as much of dose because you're much more sensitive than others. You have many more copies of certain genes that will allow you to metabolize it far better. Next slide. Same thing, a whole field has come up of nutrigenomics. And this is the study of how foods and food constituents on gene expression. For example, many, many studies today on omega-6s and omega-3s, essential fatty acids, and how their effect on the expression of genes and involved in the development of cardiovascular disease, cancer, all kinds of different conditions. So you can see genes that regulate adhesion molecules, pro-inflammatory, cytokines, all kinds of different genes get turned on by certain foods. And, you know, this is what we're all learning. The diet affects how we age, how we get disease, and now we understand what's happening. Certain diets will cause certain genes to be expressed. It'll cause all kinds of problems, whether it's cardiovascular disease or cancer. It's a huge, huge amount of research now. I mean, whole journals that weren't there a year or two ago, suddenly brand new journals publishing all kinds of studies on different foods. Next slide. All kinds of studies. Here's echinacea, which is probably the most commonly used herb in the West. And again, looking at certain cancer cells, they're looking at how they're incubated with this herb, then they're looking at the gene expression response, and they're looking at different genes here and looking at different doses. And the main thing that you get is this herb affects gene expression. Turns on some genes, turn off other genes. Next slide. So, of course, we have Ayurveda. For thousands of years, Ayurveda's had a system of personalized medicine which makes individual recommendations on diet, exercise, yoga asanas, daily and seasonal routines, purification treatments, nutritional supplements. We just had a marvelous course last weekend, wellness consultant course, where we had Vijay Gupta, very wonderful Vijay, with Stuart Rothenberg, and we had all these really interesting case studies going through, and you could just see how powerful it is. Maharishi wanted to do something even more than that, though. He really wanted to include all systems of traditional medicine, with Ayurveda being the basis of it. Next slide. Pulse diagnosis, incredible what it can do, just this feeling of the pulse on this very intuitive level. You get these individualized aspects of the person. Next slide. So in a recent study, individuals from three most contrasting constitutional types, Vata, Pitta, and Kapha, where they were just pure Vata, pure Pitta, pure Kapha, really strong, then they took blood samples and looked at biochemical and hematological parameters, and then at genomic expression. And the next slide. Next slide. Oh, here we go. That's fine. So in looking at biochemical markers, there were 15 parameters in males and 4 in females that revealed significant differences. For example, lipid profiles, cholesterol. These are all common factors for cardiovascular disease. And when they compared the Kapha to the Pitta and Vata. And the next slide, I'm going through this really quickly. I hope you don't mind, but there's not much time. So these are looking at the different parameters here. These are looking at the different Vata, Pitta, and Kapha. And the main point here is that you can look at certain blood profiles and you can distinguish Vata, Pitta, and Kapha in these blood profiles. Next slide. Now if you go to the gene level, you get the same thing. These are a group of genes that respond to stimuli. These are involved in metabolism. These are regulators of certain cellular processes, development, transport. And you can look at how Vata, Pitta, and Kapha, when people are very strong in Vata or Pitta and Kapha, how they express these genes. Again, you see differences. So it's like suddenly, you know, when a guy comes in and has his pulse and you say he's Vata, you can also say, hey, you've got these genes being expressed. This is the reason why you get this, why you're getting sick, you're not getting sick. It suddenly translates what's a very, very abstract area for most people now into a very concrete area. Next slide. You can look at different Ayurvedic herbs like turmeric. It's extensively studied, just thousands of studies on turmeric. And they, you know, typically they try to isolate the active ingredient, curcumin, and they look at how it affects the COX-2 expression, which is involved in things like arthritis and all kinds of different conditions, these cyclooxygenase enzymes. And they find that the turmeric itself is affecting gene expression of these enzymes. So that's very cool. Now we know what Ayurveda's been saying all along, that food affects your genes, diet, all these different kinds of diets affect it, herbs affect it, lifestyle, we know exercise does. Robert just presented this research on meditation does it. So we're really understanding now what's going on. Next slide. And here's ginger, again, extensively studied. And compounds isolated from ginger are highly effective in inhibiting this lipopolysaccharide-induced production of prostaglandin E2. These compounds appear to not only inhibit these COX-2 enzyme activity, but also are able to alter COX-2 messenger RNA levels, so suggesting two sites of activity. So these herbs are powerful. They are affecting how your genes are expressing certain enzymes, which are very important in a lot of different conditions in your body. We now know inflammation is one of the major killers of the world. It's involved in virtually every disease, whether it's cancer, whether it's cardiovascular disease, and there are these pathways that are very critical, and these pathways, one of the pathways results in these COX 2 or COX-1 enzymes, which make a huge difference whether you have pro-inflammatory substances produced in your body or if you have anti-inflammatory substances. So this is a big, serious concern now, chronic inflammation. And now we can show Ayurvedic herbs are affecting how this process of chronic inflammation is developing the body. Next slide. Maharishi Ayurveda, recent research. This is what Robert showed, so I can just skip this. Next slide. This is research that's ongoing here, continuing from the research that Robert was mentioned. This is another one of our graduate students, Benny Gunnan, who's looking at EEG, pulse diagnosis, genomics, what's called proteomics, and metabolomics. You can go all through this. You can get more and more cool. I mean, there may be, 30,000 genes. There's, auxilian proteins, and there are auxilian metabolic pathways. So, we'd like to find soma. We'd like to go and isolate all these cool compounds that Maharishi talked about that give rise to higher states of consciousness. And this is, Fred Travis is the main advisor on this, and it'd be very cool if we can relate EEG to genomics. I don't think anybody has ever done that. So this is very, very neat research that's going on here. It's something that, could give us an insight into what's really going on as we evolve. Next slide. Maharishi spent the last, 5 years of his life in Holland really working hard on this Maharishi Center for Perfect Health. Robert and I were there. We were working, very extensively on it. Maharishi had this wonderful plan where he created this ideal center which integrates all the most advanced approaches of modern medicine and the most authentic approaches of Ayurveda. Maharishi at one point said, anything that works is Ayurveda. That just completely, we had 50 departments. We had Chinese medicine, we had homeopathy. We never even talked about these things before. Maharishi was open to everything. And he wanted to integrate it all with modern medicine. So this was a really incredible unfoldment of knowledge that Maharishi was bringing out. He wanted to really create the DNA of a hospital that could cure anything. And he was open to any possible kind of program that could do it. But we just had to, authenticate it. We had to find out what worked. Guy came in, gets his MRI, gets his pulse, gets all kinds of things. And then we find out which works best. And really, I wish at that time we could have told Maharishi more about all this research on DNA, because that was the direction Maharishi kept pushing us in, always in that direction. And here it just came up, this fantastic research, which is giving us a way of authenticating Ayurveda, a way of authenticating all these things that, we love scientific research if it helps tell us what's going on and how it's going on. And it's obviously a very, very intricate world. We're almost like on the devatal level. We're in that very, very fine level where things are changing. So we could see, using DNA as kind of the tool, figuring out what's getting turned on, what's getting turned off, and what is the ideal diet? What is the ideal herbs? What are the ideal things for any person that will ensure that, when the influenza A virus is injected in him, that he doesn't get it, and then, he has that kind of tuning of the immune system so he can prevent any danger before it arises. Last slide here. So this is Maharishi saying when the total intelligence of natural law Veda is lively in the individual physiology, there is perfect synchrony between the functioning of the body as a whole and between individual intelligence and cosmic intelligence. With this complete integration, all thought and action are spontaneously in harmony with natural law, and the individual enjoys perfect health. And, Maharishi, we had this wonderful lecture I remember one time giving with Maharishi, and he loved to talk about how the TM City program, all these advanced programs were like cosmic switches that would turn on and off the DNA. So Maharishi was thinking this right back then. He knew this was going on in that very subtle level. And now it's fun that modern science is finally catching up to Maharishi. Thank you very much.